scripture about praying. What do y'all think?
Okay.
Let's actually pray.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay.
How about we all pray? Brandon, you want to start?
Yeah.
Okay.
Dear Lord, which art in heaven, lead us and guide us about what's the message today. Dear Heavenly Father, also, lead Terry, lead her, God Terry, be with her. Also, Lord, be with the people that's got the coronavirus and heal the coronavirus. I still dear Lord, I know it's not good, but the virus is just a spread out. It's getting bad, and we need a healing touch. The people need a healing touch from by you. Let them know that you're with them. Let them know and speak to their hearts, Lord. Let them know who you are. Also, Lord, thanks for the warm weather that we're having. Also, Lord, I would love you and we believe in you. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for allowing us to come together. Lord, we have, you know what's on my heart. I've got a lot of prayer requests I need left up to you, Lord. Tracy, Rayleigh, Blake, Nate. Lord, you know that situation that's going on there. I ask for prayers for them. I also ask for prayers for Kobe and Amy. We want to pray for them, too. We know there's a strife and a struggle going on there with that family, and we want to pray for them. I also want to pray for Kim. I lift her up in her situation she's got going now. She's suffering from headaches, Lord. I understand it. The allergies. I even want to pray for myself. I've been suffering through these allergies, Lord. Lord, we just want to lift these people up to you. There's so much more on our list to lift up to you. Dee, Terry, I want to lift up Randy and Billy and Randy's sister and my husband, Colton, Mickey, Janie. Everybody that's involved in our little church, I'd like to lift up to you, Lord. Lord, I don't want to forget to thank you, though. Thank you for the blessings that you've given us, the blessings you are giving us. And this is a blessing for us just to be together in this time and this space, Heavenly Father. I thank you so much for everything that you have given us, Lord, and we love you. Lord, hear our prayers.
Almighty King of all the universe, We praise you in your holy name that is exalted on high. Lord God, we come to you in a time of learning. Today we ask that you work into our lives, that you allow your Holy Spirit to flow through us as we study and try to understand what you have taught us. Lord God, we thank you so much for everything that you've given us, for our friends, our loved ones, for our church, for, Lord God, for all. We ask that you continue to be with us today. Look over our weaknesses and lift us up, and Lord God, make us perfect in your power. Merciful God, we lift up to you many things, our friends, our loved ones, the illnesses out there. Lord God, today, let us lift you up, for you are everything to us. Enlighten us and help us understand more about prayer. Fill our hearts with things of yours. Fill our minds with your wisdom and knowledge. Lord God, we thank you so much for letting us be here. Lord God, teach us how to pray. In your holy name we pray, and all the church said.
Amen.
So, obviously, the Lord teaches us to pray. Out of all the things that the disciples could have asked, they could have said, how do you perform miracles? How do you move things? How do you move mountains? How do you bring people back from the dead? How do you walk on water? The thing that they decided to ask Jesus was, Lord, teach us how to pray. It's because they knew Jesus is direct link to God the Father, the Holy Spirit, is how Jesus got power on this earth. And they wanted to understand what that was and how that worked. So when we say, Lord, teach us how to pray, it helps understand more of God. It helps understand more of humanity and understand how we are to link to the Lord God in this three-person state. And what Jesus taught them said, pray like this. And I know y'all know it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. When Jesus spoke these words, he didn't actually speak the last half in that prayer, but the last portion, the doxa part. He spoke the first part in the scriptures that were written. So, we got to think, what does this mean? I want to answer some questions today, and I want to start off, we may not get through all of it in the 45 minutes we have left, but I still want to touch on some of it, and I want to kind of get into it, but we're not even going to get to that prayer to start off with. I want to talk about why prayer, what is prayer, the essential forms of prayer, and do we know how to pray, and what can the Lord's Prayer is going to teach us. That's going to be the last section. But the first thing I want to start off is, why prayer? In the book of James, and if y'all want to help, in the book of James 5:16 says, therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. A prayer of a righteous person has great power in its working. Prayer can be extremely powerful. It can move things. It can change the world, but prayer can also be weak in a sense, can't it? But a prayer that is fervent and given in the way. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. John 14:14. As long as it's within the will of God, things do amazing things. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, it says, if my people are called by my name, who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, and I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. I think this is an important thing that Jesus came into, that he was teaching. Because he went into a society where everybody was keeping up prayers, and they were just saying them to say them out loud, and they were teaching in prayers. And in church, we're really bad about that sometimes because we try to teach while we're praying. But really, what is prayer in its most basic thing? In its most basic sense, what is prayer?
Conversation with God.
It's a conversation with God. And it's not a conversation with Randy. It's not a conversation with Amy or with Adam. It's a conversation with God. So when we pray, we're not necessarily talking to anyone but God. If other people overhear it and we're praying aloud, that's okay. But it's still a conversation with God, not with people. And I'm just as guilty as the rest of the pastors out there. Sometimes I pray and I'm trying to teach a lesson while I'm praying, like two birds in one stone. And it's hard not to sometimes, because it's a time of speaking out loud. I don't know. When is a time where prayer has changed something in your life that you've seen? Either of you?
All the time.
All the time? Can you name an instance?
The time that, when we were all praying for Tracy, we get to a position where she can, with Rayleigh and her health situation, and that answers would be given. And they were, and the timing was perfect, and everything just fell into place.
Yeah.
And it was at the right time. If it happened earlier, it wouldn't have worked. If it happened later, it would have been missed. It was just perfect timing.
Yeah.
Little things. It's not necessarily big things all the time. You know, I think we forget when we pray and we're having a conversation with God is that we're wanting the big miracles. And it's the small things. It's the everyday things. It really is. I woke up this morning, I'm breathing. The sun's shining. That in itself is an answer to prayer. So it's the everyday little things. It's not the big miracles we need to look for. We talk. I mean, you walk in on me all the time. You see me talking. Like the other day, you're like, you're just having a conversation. Yeah, sorry.
How about you, Randy?
Well, I mean, I think I won some souls when I was at the National Church. Because when I was playing all these songs and singing them, and what I wrote some songs.
Mm-hmm.
And now some of the songs, pretty fair, and some of them was not pretty good, so, but I did the best ones I got now is Sanctify My Soul, and the other one is Those Waves. That's my main two, that's the best ones. The rest of them didn't come out good, so it didn't, when I played it and sang it, it didn't sound nice.
Yeah.
So I don't know how I got that, but I did it, but I sang it and I played it.
In C.S. Lewis's book, The Magician's Nephew, he wrote that the lion, Aslan, who's basically portraying Jesus, roared the world into existence. But when he was roaring the world into existence, it sounded like a song. So many people forget that singing is a form of prayer in a lot of ways, especially singing in church. I like the Reformed Church, the Presbyterian Church, has an interesting view on prayer, on songs that they sing in church. A lot of times they don't sing newer songs. What they do is they sing psalters. And psalters are songs that are written purely from the Psalms. And they put them to modern tunes, or they put them to tunes that they realize that they, like tunes that they know. And it's really interesting to see how much work they put into it, but it's an interesting way of praying the scriptures. Well, lifting up God, lifting it up to God at the same time, because the Psalms are a lot of prayer.
I find that interesting because if you look into other cultures, Muslim, Judaism, they, especially those two, they sing their prayers.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you're in a Middle Eastern country, and you're listening to the prayers going through the town, it is almost hypnotic,
yeah,
in a way, because you just want to stop and listen and just be still, because you just can almost feel it. And so I think praying, singing those prayers falls right along what you do, Randy, with your songs. Those are your prayers to God.
Yeah.
And I think, and that's a beautiful gift.
Yeah.
So, We talked about what is prayer, but I might have made it a little bit longer than that needed to, but prayer is believing or thinking or believing in the presence of God, as well as asking Him for good things and aligned to His will. Prayer is a divine gift. God always longs to encounter the human family. It flows from a personal and living relationship of believers with the Lord. God's Spirit dwells in believers' hearts and intercedes for God's people in accordance to God in Romans 8:27. Because in and of ourselves we do not know what we ought to pray for, Romans 8:26. So, oftentimes we don't know what to pray for. We do intercession prayers. We pray for people. We think we're praying for what is right. But honestly, sometimes we don't know. Are we bending God's will? Are we praying God's will? Are we lifting up what God wants? Or are we lifting up something that we want? When we're praying...
Well, God put these prayers in the Bible.
Yeah.
Maybe He wants us to use those prayers.
I think so.
Instead of the other prayers on how we've been praying now.
I think sometimes we need to...
If we say, Lord God, which art in heaven, and we call Him by His name, maybe He still hears. So.
Yeah. But we know prayer is a two-way communication, right? We know it goes both ways. He will call on me, and I will answer Him. I will be Him in trouble, and I will deliver Him and honor Him. Psalm 91:15. The Psalms are really good for having understanding of prayer, because David spent a lot of time praying, and so did Solomon. They really did. And they lifted up whatever they could because they had a lot to pray for.
Yeah.
I don't know. We must listen. I always love the calling of Samuel. And the Lord came and stood calling three other times, Samuel, Samuel, and Samuel said, speak for your servant hears. He says, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. But we think about that whole Samuel thing. We think about the calling. How often do we not listen to God when God is speaking to us? You know, I talked about that before. Sometimes it's hard to listen to God and look for providence in what's going on, looking for God's workings. We ask, we pray, and then we move on. We expect, instead of looking for providence.
You know, I find frustrations a lot of times, not a lot of times, but there are moments where I'm leading 5-year-olds, or I'm leading a Bible study, or I'm leading worship, or whatever. And I know, Adam, you ran into this. Where we pray, and at times, I feel like I'm regurgitating. Because that's what I feel like they all want to hear. And at times, I just want to say, let's all just be still in a moment of silent prayer and just let God speak to us. Because maybe we need to just shut up and listen for a minute.
True.
And there are times where I just wanted to say that and go, can we just all be quiet to silently pray?
God is not going to answer us right away. Not fast.
Sometimes He does.
Sometimes it does, but
I think sometimes what I'm saying is it's not a matter of God answering our prayer.
Yeah.
Sometimes God already knows what we're going to pray for.
Yeah, yeah.
God already knows what's on our hearts.
Yeah.
He already knows what's going on.
Yeah.
He just wants to know that we're listening to Him and that we're communicating with Him.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're coming to with Him to an open heart.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, 1 Samuel right there, where he called Samuel out 3 times, speak for your servant hears. I think sometimes He just wants us to listen
yeah,
and be still.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes it takes patience for him to respond back.
Yeah, sometimes he's not going to answer you. He just wants you to be quiet for a minute.
Yeah.
And I think part of that being still and being quiet is opening your heart and opening your mind so you're not confusing and thinking, well, okay, did I get this person right? I need to pray for this person. And sometimes it's just like, be still.
That's the whole point. Don't worry. You know, listening to God is something that is not an easy practice. Listening to God act in our lives is not something that we naturally do. I don't know. We seem like children sometimes. We, hey, dad. You remember the little kid just kind of harassing their parents?
Are we there yet? Yeah.
You know, it seems like we're always doing that to God, and we, especially when we really get into repeating our prayers, like you said, sometimes it feels like, okay, we took prayer requests, now we're all praying for the prayer requests that we just talked about out loud, instead of saying, hey God, this is yours, take it.
Yeah, because I feel like we've already said it.
It feels redundant.
Yeah. I'm regurgitating.
You're regurgitating. It's a redundant thing. It seems to go. I don't know if you notice when I pray, I often don't repeat direct prayer requests on purpose. And it's not because I'm glazing over stuff and don't want to memorize it. It's just because God hears it. God hears what we say. God hears what we ask for. And He hears what we call for. It doesn't matter. It doesn't take a special person to lift it up that way. You know, that's the nifty thing about the priesthood of all believers. It doesn't require me to lift it up. It doesn't require Brandy to lift it up. It just, somebody lifts it up. And as long as it's being prayed for, it's being prayed for, and God knows. And God already knows before we even pray for it. But we have to listen. And I think sometimes we forget providence works in our lives. And I say providence, acts of God. Sometimes God doesn't speak so much with words, and when God does, it scares the crap out of me. I'm not going to lie. But when God speaks with other people and with other things in our lives, with just providential actions, it's fun. It's amazing. Because when you say, God, I need somebody right now to witness to because my head just needs it. And all of a sudden, they're there. And you get to do it. Or you're driving down the street and you get this feeling, I need to stop. And you go talk to somebody and say, God wanted me to say this. Because God does put that in your heart. He does it on a regular basis if you stop and listen. But as Christians, especially as American Christians, we don't listen to anybody. We may hear, but we rarely listen and take it in. Maybe the cat's in the bedroom too.
No. She was just
So, it's important.
Can I say this? And I'm just going to throw this out there, and you know this, because you and I have talked about this. But I don't know if you know this, maybe. I think for me, right before I go to sleep, as I'm falling asleep, I just say, God, I'm going to listen to you tonight in my sleep. And since I have been doing that, I wake up with these songs in my head. I wake up with these. I've been having the most wonderful dreams. Half of them I can't remember anymore. But I feel like He's talking to me. Because that's when I'm dead asleep, I'm wide open, maybe, whatever.
Yeah.
I just ask Him, don't give me a lot loud audible when it be in the middle of the night. You might scare me. But I think that's when we can be most open.
Yeah.
That's just been my experience recently.
I like to sit quiet and listen to God, see what God says. haven't done that in a while, but I'm going to sit down here and be quiet and see what he's got to say.
It is fun. It's hard. And trying to block everything else out.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's hard to shut your head off.
You had that the other night. You had a hard time shutting your head off the other night.
No, it had nothing to do with God.
Well, I know it did. But it's just...
It had to do with me. I don't know. Let me just go with... Sorry. Alright. So, what is prayer? Essential forms of prayer. Okay. Yeah, there's lots of words up on the screen, but we're going to go through some of them. Timothy, 1 Timothy 2, 1 and 2 talks about, only talks about worship and doxology. Prayer and worship go hand in hand. When you're speaking to God, you say worshipful things about God, to God. You remember God's history. You remember God's past. When Jesus says, hallowed be thy name, that's that doxa moment, that lifting it up to God, getting God do what God is due.
Right.
And it's an important part of prayer that we have to remember that doxology part, that worshipful part of our prayers. So often we say we use God like a genie, especially in our modern day age. God, please fix this. God, please fix this. God, please fix this. Whatever happened to God, you are awesome. God, you are amazing. God, I love you. God, you've done amazing things in my life. You've done this, this, and this. God, the historical events of the Bible, you created this, this, and this, and you made this happen. Why don't we do that all the time? So often we get roped into the praying for our needs, and we forget about how awesome our God is. So the worshipful part is necessary in our prayer. Supplication or petition, that's obviously what we're doing. Lord, my arm's broken, fix it. Please, God, make it better. Make my back not hurt anymore.
Yeah. I've done a lot of supplication.
You know, intercession. Intercession is one of the most powerful things we can do for another person, and that is praying for another individual. It's like praying, Lord, help Janie not be lonely because she's not out. Reminder that we're here for her. It's important that we pray for the people that we know and that we intercede for them. But we can't just have a list of 1,000 people because it's hard to remember them. And it seems like it's just rote. Okay, I'm praying for this person. Okay, I'm praying for this person. Okay, I'm praying for this person. We need to stop doing that and remember intercessory prayer is very personal. Oh God, Randy is a good guy. I pray that you lift him up through this time, his arm. What do you do with his wife? Watch over her. Make it personal. Make it not just something small, something quick and to the point. If it means you pray for less people, you pray for less people. And intercession is something that is very important because the more you pray for somebody, the more knowledge and wisdom God's going to give you about that person.
Yeah.
It's going to grow in. If you continue to pray for somebody, they're going to be in the front of your heart. And all of a sudden, that person that you pray for is really somebody important to your life.
Yeah.
And intercession is important not just for our relationship with God, but our relationship with others and our relationship with ourselves. So, intercession or invoking God's power upon somebody's behalf. Thanksgiving or benediction. Sometimes we forget to thank God for the things we get. Like Randy, thank God for the heat. I don't know if I'd thank God for the heat.
I did kind of giggle when he said that. I did giggle.
But we have to realize without the heat, we would have cold because the absence of warmth is nothing. And with extreme coldness comes death. And so the heat is actually a good thing because it comes from the sun, which comes from God, which brings life onto the earth. And God is the light of the world. Therefore, the heat is important, even though it drives us crazy.
Just hear God, suck it up,
buttercup. Yeah. So, Christians, in fact, can follow an example of Jesus to embrace a life of prayer. John Wesley considered... Okay, you know who John Wesley is, Randy?
I used to have his Bible collection.
Okay.
John Wesley had a, he had a Bible volume, the Bibles.
Yeah.
Book volumes. I had that in the mail once. I don't know what I've done with it.
John Wesley was the founder of the Methodist movement.
Really?
So think us. He's our theological grandfather for the Nazarenes because we came from the Methodist movement. The United Methodist Church, the AME Church, the CME Church, the Wesleyan Church, many of the Pentecostal Church of God in Christ.
I can remember it was John Wesley. I'm not sure. It had John something Wesley, something like that.
It could have been. And he did. He wrote a lot.
Yeah?
Yeah, he did. He wrote a lot. The nifty thing about John Wesley, he didn't just found a movement. He owned a publishing house, and all the money from the publishing house went to the church. And he was actually an Anglican priest.
Really?
From the Church of England. Yes. He was an Anglican priest, and he thought there was a better way of doing things. And so what he tried to do is he tried to create small groups that could work together and help people grow in faith. And it was a way to create a community or a connectional group. And that's why we're called the Hope Connection, because of Wesley's introduction of connectionalism, of connecting people to God and connecting people to each other. And it's all done in that sort of fashion, through the love of God. And so John was our theological grandfather.
I don't know what I've done with his collection.
I've got
volume collection. It was some kind of an envelope. It's a volume of books on it. That John Wesley. I don't know what I've done with it.
Well, he considered prayer to be the most important means of grace and the principal activity in the works of piety. In other words, personal holiness. Works of mercy. So prayer preceded piety, or personal holiness, preceded mercy, doing good, and that they were expressions of prayer. Christian prayer asks for God for personal needs, prayers for consummation of God's kingdom, and intercedes for the salvation of all persons. Basically, prayer needs to precede everything. It needs to go before everything we do, especially in ministry. It needs to go in everything we do. So when we're working with people and discipling people, we need to be praying constantly. When we're talking to strangers about Jesus, we need to be praying constantly. While we're digging holes to build a new church building, we need to be praying to God, thanking God for this opportunity to build his church from the ground up, or to build a congregation from the ground up. Prayer is something that I think I haven't focused on enough since we've been here. And I think prayer needs to be more of a focus as we go on. Because prayer changes us. It doesn't change God. God is God. Prayer changes us. It's not really a quote.
It's one of his principles.
Yeah, you can do whatever.
Yeah.
Interactive prayer. Or inactive prayer. James 2:14 through 17. Do we know how to pray? What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has all the faith but has not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of them says, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things they need for their body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have have works, is dead. Inactive prayer. I always love inactive prayer, because it's something the church is really good about. We love doing inactive, and I don't mean just our congregation, I mean the whole church. We like praying for stuff and not doing anything about it. It's like all of a sudden we've had all responsibility removed from ourselves. Oh Lord God, heal me. Heal my bad back. But I'm going to go outside and play football. Oh, Lord God, pray, heal my wife. Make her perfectly fine, but tell her to go mow the lawn. just little things that we do the opposite of what we pray for.
Yeah.
Lord God, grant me wisdom, but we won't crack a book. God, give me knowledge, but we won't open the Bible. We pray for these things, but we forget. God gives us the chance to do things for ourselves. God, make me skinny, and I go to McDonald's and have 20-piece chicken nuggets.
Inactive. This reminds me of the fact that I lately, I don't know why, I have said this several times to several different Christians, and I've said, God gave you common sense. Seriously, He gave you common sense. Use it. I think this is where inactive prayer comes in, because, is there a spider?
Nope.
Oh, okay. This is where I think people with the inactive prayer, we pray for stuff, but we don't use the common sense God gave us to resolve what we're praying for, when God's like, giving you all the, here you go. It reminds me of the story of the man who's drowning.
Or praying for people to come to your church.
Lord God, but not going out
and finding them. And when God does send them, you scare them off.
Yes.
And I've seen that in more churches than I want to admit. And some of them I pastored. And it broke my heart to see people scaring people off.
Yeah.
Because not everybody's ready for all 100% church. But they're ready for 100% love. They're ready to receive.
Right.
And it just has to be done within normal human limits.
We don't need to run them off.
And we don't need to run them off. People do it all the time. Or, like, when people come to church, like, invite someone to church, and then all of a sudden somebody starts talking. Somebody comes to church that came through a drug ministry, a ministry meant to help people get off drugs. And then somebody in here talks about holiness and how drugs are bad and people that do drugs are bad and that they need to go to hell and all that. That's not what it's about. It's about, hey, drugs are bad, but come hang out with us. There's no stipulations. Just try not to be high when you come. That kind of stuff. We need to just accept people for who they are and allow God to change them and realize that I can't change any person. You can't change any person. Amy can't change anybody but ourselves. And even then, there's limits. It requires God to change people. And we need to pray and be doing. It's the same. It's like praying for somebody to come and they need something and we don't help them.
Yeah, that's a big decision.
And we need to also ask them what they need. We need to be willing to listen to them too, not just God.
I've started to get into the habit of when somebody comes to mind, that I've started now that I'll send them a text or a quick message, and I will tell them, I'm thinking about you. I love you, and I'm praying for you. And I really am praying for them at that very moment, because they came to mind for a reason. So I'm trying to do active intercessory prayer all at the same time by letting them know I'm praying for you, and at the same time asking God, I know you brought them on my mind, so I'm just touching base with them, telling them I love them, I pray. Because sometimes people don't want a whole, how are you doing? What's been going on? Sometimes they just don't want to talk. They just want to know
that somebody just prayed for them.
That somebody just prayed for them, that we're there, and that we love them. And sometimes that's all it is. And I have been trying to do that more lately when someone comes to mind. It's like,
to time, we're all guilty of ineffective prayer.
Yeah.
We all are. I mean, it just happens to be that we're not always praying in God's will. And then sometimes we forget that we can do things to change people's lives on our own, too. Every one of us has two arms and two legs. Maybe one of them doesn't work so well, but we all do. We all can walk, we can all talk, we can all help people, we can all lift people up, we can all pray for people, but we can also go do things for people.
Yeah.
Randy's comes with an extra guilt trip because he's like, my arm's broken, but I'm helping you. You know, Randy's got some power right now.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. Let me help you carry that. I only have one arm, but I'll help you carry it.
Yeah. See how I broke it up.
So, I don't know. It's something that we have to be careful that our prayer is effective.
Yeah.
And that we're in line with what we're praying for.
Yeah.
And before we pray for something, we should think, can we do something about it too?
I think social media has really created the inactive prayer. It bugs me to no end when I see people that I know don't go to church, don't understand prayer, don't even pray, that say, well, I'm praying for you and I want to go, really? You're you? I know you. And maybe that's judgmental of me, and I apologize if that is. But I think this is where our society has got to this point of inactive prayer. Because my friends and my family know when I say I'm praying for you, they know she just prayed.
Yeah.
She did just say a prayer for me or that individual.
Back to the first question. What is the purpose of prayer?
It's having that conversation.
Honestly, I'm not a big fan of putting that I prayed on people's things. I pray. If I see a prayer request, I pray for it. But I don't put that I prayed. And that drove Terry nuts the other day. Because I prayed, but didn't say that I prayed. Because I don't have to say that I prayed.
Right.
Because it's not my communication with Terry. Or it's not my communication with you or anybody. It's my communication with God.
And sometimes for that other person, it really isn't about you.
Yeah, I know.
It's about them getting that confirmation.
Yeah.
It's about them feeling like they've been heard.
But really, they need to be hearing from God.
Right. I understand that. But it also goes back to sometimes it's not about them.
But it can be a teachable moment.
It can be.
It can be a teachable moment because I know certain people pray for me, and I know they do always. I know of several people that pray for me daily.
Yeah.
And I thank God that they're there because I don't know what I would do if people weren't praying for me regularly. I pray for my family regularly because I know nobody else is going to. I pray for your immediate family regularly, just your immediate family. I don't go too far beyond the kids. Because your family gets kind of wackadoo and crazy. So, Paul and the kids is about as far as I go.
You know, pray for my cousins, and second cousins, and third cousins. What good are you?
You know, and then I do have a distinct set prayer list. I do. I pray for the people that we come in contact with our ministry. I pray for our originals, you know, the three that were here when I got here. But I also pray for some of the others that are in contact every day.
But I
don't pray for 500 people.
See, I don't have a list.
I do.
And I don't make a list. And here's why. If I make a list, I'm going to forget to pray for the people that aren't on the list.
See, I pray for those
the ones we don't know about yet.
Well, I still pray for providence, too.
But I think I'm getting back on... I want to get back onto this inactive prayer. Because I want to get back on this. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
But I think our church as a whole, and I'm talking worldwide, I'm not just talking about the Nazarene Church, I'm talking about the Universal Catholic Church.
Yeah.
Church Catholic, sorry. We have really allowed inactive prayer to become a staple in our churches. I feel like I think people meaningfully pray, but don't understand that, yes, I can pray very meaningfully. I can pray and mean to, I'm sorry, are we going back?
No, no, keep going.
That I mean to pray for this person, but it's like you said, then if God says, okay, well, you prayed for this person, why don't you give him a call? And you don't call him, you've made that prayer inactive. Or you don't go see him, you've made that prayer inactive. Or if you don't do something that you know is going to help, you've made it. I think we miss the point of when we pray, well, I pray meaningfully. I've given it to God. I've done this. You can make your meaningful prayer inactive.
Well, we do that all the time. A lot of times when we're praying for wisdom, and knowledge, and God gives us the wisdom and knowledge, then we don't use it.
And we don't use it, yeah.
Or pray. I love people that pray for faith, but don't have faith in their faith.
Yeah.
Or you know, and you see people praying for healing, but
won't go see a doctor.
Won't go see a doctor, or when they do, they're rude to their doctor and nurses.
Or they won't tell the doctor what's really
wrong.
Or
they won't tell them what's wrong and yeah. Say, well, God, if they're supposed to know, God's going to tell them.
Oh, I love that.
There's just so many things that, you know, or praying to speak in tongues. I'm not taking a jab at anybody. But praying to speak in tongues and then not learning another language.
Or knowing that's not your spiritual gift.
Or, spiritual gifts change. They evolve.
They do. They do. But I'm never going to ask the Lord, hey, can you let me speak in tongues? Because I know.
I promise you.
That is just not happening.
When it comes down to Hebrew and Greek class, you're going to be praying for tongues. I know when I took Hebrew and Greek, I was like, Lord Jesus, teach me, give me some tongues now. Lord, put it on me. I want to understand what these words mean.
Oh, Lord.
I can't even memorize the alphabet. Lord Jesus, teach me. And you're going to be praying for it.
Well,
but you have to study it, too.
Yeah, I get that.
So, you know, what I'm trying to say is prayer is big. It's huge. And today we didn't even get to break down the Lord's Prayer.
I'm sorry.
No, that was intentional. I actually expected it to take 2 weeks. Because I wanted to talk about what prayer is, what prayer isn't. And when you come back next week, I want you to think about this specific prayer.
Yeah.
And what each line means to you. When we say Our Father, what does Abba mean to you? What does it mean? You know, who art in heaven? What's heaven? What does it mean to say that God is in heaven? Hallowed be thy name. What does it mean for God to be holy? And what does that mean in our stance as a Christian person? Thy kingdom come. We want God's kingdom. Why do we want God's kingdom? Is it good? Is it not good the way we're doing it? Can it be better? Thy will be done. Why is God's will, why should it supersede our own? That's a good question. And a lot of people don't know why. On earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. It's kind of funny that we say that and then we don't give to other people. forgive us our trespasses. We do sin from time to time, even though as Nazarenes we seek piety towards entire holiness and entire sanctification. Sometimes we do fall short of God's glory. But do we always forgive the trespasses of others? That's normally where we get lost, is forgiving others for their sinful actions. You know? There's a few names that I can say that instantaneously bring up anger and strife in my heart, and I know in Amy's heart, and I'm sure there's a few that bring up anger in your heart.
Not too much anymore.
Wayne.
No. That never.
Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. What is evil? That's always a fun one to ask. Think about these questions as we go along. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. That's the doxa part. How do we put worship in our prayer? What Jesus has here is a model prayer. And we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about it line by line. We're going to get into it next week. But it's important that we realize that it is a model prayer. So when we pray, we take each section and work it into our prayer. I tried doing that a little bit as I prayed today. It's not easy to do. It's not easy to work every section into one prayer. But it doesn't mean we can't work it into our prayers over a day. So, as we close today, let's say the Lord's Prayer, and let's say it together, but let's really think about what we're saying, and we'll say it kind of slow so we can think about it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.